you imagine that we're sitting here and you're listening to me talking, but also a car goes past, you can distinguish these two sounds in your mind. They're two separate entities. And similarly, if you're listening to an orchestra, you can hear the violin, you can hear the oboe, you can hear the voice. And if you think about what's actually happening in your brain, that's rather remarkable, because what's reaching your ear is just a single sound wave. And yet our brain is able to break the sound wave up into its composite parts. And that is an example of something that we call a Fourier transform. So it's, in some sense, you're given some signal and you want to distill it into its fundamental components. And Fourier, so the theory of Fourier series is a very old subject, very beautiful subject. And in some sense, representation theory, which is my field, is some very vast generalization of the theory of Fourier series. I never found mathematics particularly deep or inspiring in school. For me, it was something that I could do easily, but I didn't find it profound. I found poetry profound, I found philosophy profound. And then I remember in third year in undergrad in Sydney, I went to a course on Galois theory. And I saw a subject that I just never ever would have come up with had I thought about it for a long, 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 long time. And I was absolutely amazed at the depth of this subject. And in some sense, this is a subject that is still very alive today, Galois theory. So this was definitely a turning point to see the depth that mathematics is capable of. I've actually spent quite a lot of time thinking about what motivates me in mathematics. I think that one aspect of it is just the incredible beauty of the theory, both in its kind of broader sense and also in the specificity of the examples, and the fact that you can really work something out and see that a number is one or two is very exciting. On the other hand, so Barry Mazur calls mathematics humanity's longest conversation. And I think that this is a really beautiful description of how we function as a mathematical community, that where I kind of imagine us all sitting around this enormous table and you work very hard to be able to say one little thing in this long conversation that is mathematics. And I find the social aspect of mathematics incredibly inspiring, and the exposure to many different ideas, many different people, the ability to travel, the ability to collaborate. These are extremely strong motivations for me now as a mathematician. And I don't think that that was so much the case when I began. When I began, I just wanted to understand and I wanted to sit in my room and I wanted to work things out. Whereas now I feel much more like I'm part of an amazing community. I had two very difficult times in my career. One was as a PhD student. So I arrived and I had this fantastic advisor who saw the world in a very abstract way. He's a theory builder, not a problem solver as such. And he was explaining to me how I should go about solving various problems. And I think by nature, I'm much more of a problem solver. And at some point I decided to go to Denmark for a period of time. And in this period of time, I decided I'm going to show him that he's wrong, that I can just solve this by hand. And I completely and utterly failed. And also, it was incredibly dark in Denmark. Every day I felt like there was no daylight and I was riding my bike to and from the office in the darkness. And at that point I vowed that I'm just going to finish this thesis however I can and then leave mathematics and never ever come back. And this was a really important time for me because it made me realize that there's many problems in mathematics you can't just attack straight away. The other very difficult time was as a postdoc. I just found it very lonely experience, I was working very hard, I didn't have many friends. You also move a lot as a postdoc, you're traveling a lot, so it's very difficult to establish meaningful relationships. I think that we underestimate the psychological burden that we put on ourselves and our PhD students. And the more that I talk to mathematicians, I realize that often people have had you know, periods of illness or periods of, you know, mental health issues or things like that. But we don't talk about that so much, and I think that's a pity. I definitely feel a genuine sadness that I can't tell people about some of the most beautiful mathematical theories that exist. So one example of this is something called the Weyl conjectures. For me, this is one of the most extraordinary achievements of humankind. I find it absolutely remarkable. It's just as remarkable as a moon landing or something like that. And yet, almost nobody in the world knows about this. So it makes me sad, and I also think that this can lead to loneliness, but I also think that we can make an effort to communicate more. Yeah, so this discovery of this family of counterexamples to the expected bounds in Lustig's conjecture was a very, very interesting process for me. I was in Hong Kong visiting Xu Ha He, and he was asking me to explain an enormous amount of the theory. And I basically spent hours and hours every day at the whiteboard in his office explaining. And he was asking extremely good questions, and we were trying to work on it. And I think in some sense he was allowing me to put together a whole lot of pieces of a puzzle. And after that I went to Beijing, and I arrived in Beijing, and I remember everything was kind of swirling around in my head, but I had no idea that I was about to have this idea. And then, yeah, I was in the shower and I just suddenly realized, it's the only time in my life where I suddenly realized that something was possible. At other points when I've solved something, it's a gradual process and you start feeling more and more optimistic and things start to feel more and more solid. Whereas here it was just boom, it came immediately. And of course I needed to check it, but there was a real kind of moment where suddenly it became clear under the shower. So the Lustig conjecture was a central open problem in our field. And it was put forward in 1980 by George Lustig. And he proposed a way to solve this conjecture, which was carried out in the 90s. But somehow it only said that it is true in the vast majority of cases. So, but there was always this question of what about these special cases? So for us, this is for small prime numbers. And I discovered that the conjecture was not correct. And it was very interesting because I was in Beijing at the time, and I went to, just after that, there was a conference in Zhangjiajie where Lustig was actually present. And I was going to announce the fact that this conjecture was incorrect in certain cases. And I told him this, and he was very, very shocked initially, but very, very soon he understood what I was saying, was also able to explain it to others. And I was amazed at the speed at which he took on these new ideas. I have to say that psychologically for me, it was quite shocking, because we as a field had been operating under the assumption that it was true. And I had also been operating under the assumption that it was true and that we would prove it. So to suddenly realize that the situation was much, much, much more complicated than we first thought, it felt like a step backwards for me. And I think other people felt this too. And so I remember that for a few weeks afterwards, I would actually wake up in the middle of the night almost having a nightmare about the fact that it was not true. There's one thing that I would like to say with the Lustig conjecture stuff that I find fascinating. So, you know, I was working very hard on this problem for a long period of time from various different points of view. And at some point I did these calculations with my collaborator Ben Elias, and I was very, very happy with four of them, and I put them up on my wall in Bonn, and I was looking at them every day. And I'd had them up for about 2 years before I went to Hong Kong, and then I had this idea, and then I came back, and the remarkable thing that was that it was incredibly close to one of the pictures on the wall. And so in some sense, for a very long period of time, I'd been staring at the answer and not realized it. Yeah, so a few times I've suddenly had the feeling that something is solved. And it's an incredibly beautiful feeling. And there's a standard joke amongst amongst mathematicians that when you get this feeling, you should just go and have a holiday because it's so nice, and almost certainly you actually haven't solved it. Almost certainly you're making a mistake. And I have to say that of the 10 kind of eureka moments that I felt in my life, 8 of them have been wrong. I never admit to myself that I cannot solve it, but I admit to myself that I need a break. So I think it's extremely healthy for me particularly. I've discovered that it's very healthy for me to move between problems. And so I think I'm quite good at being able to say, okay, stop thinking about that. I'm not always good, but I try. Stop thinking about that and start thinking about this. And you're allowed to come back to this later, but at the moment you're stuck. I mean, we have something within ourselves that's very special, which is some way of thinking about things. If I look at mathematicians that I admire, you can see that often they use the same technique throughout their lives, and they're very good at that technique, and that is somehow inherent to them. And I think that it's very important to try not to stifle what is in you. But I'm not sure how one manages to do this. Have a small peek at this incredibly rich world of modular representation theory that I think is waiting for us. I would love to understand there's very interesting connections with number theory, and I would love to understand these connections more deeply. I would love to understand what's going on in this conjecture with Lustig. I thought about it very hard and banned myself from thinking about it for some time because I made almost no progress on it. And I think I'm just really looking forward to continue exploring the mathematical world.